In this lecture, we will deal with Sufism, which is a very significant aspect of Indian history. The word Sufism is derived from the word Suf, which in Arabic means coarse wool. The Sufis generally used to wear garments made of Suf or coarse wool and thus came to be known as Sufis. They were known as people who were free from worldly desires. These people did not practice the orthodox form of Islam, but gave rise to a mystical tradition which emphasized on the exploration of spirituality within human beings. So the Sufis were not inclined to the practice of rituals, prayers, fasting, and other tenets of Islam. In their spiritual quest, they were not alone, but shared the philosophy of mystical traditions found in other religions such as Christianity, Judaism, Hinduism, and Buddhism.
In order to experience the divine light in heart, this divine light includes the divine knowledge as well as the divine love.
In India, the Sufi movement began as a response to the increasing materialism pervading the Muslim society under the growing influence of the Muslim rulers all over the country. The Sufis stressed on harmony and synchronic growth in the society and also harped on the unity of human beings.
In India, Sufism started with the coming of the great Sufi Khwaja Moin-ud-din-Chishti to this country. He came to India after the Battle of Thrain in the year 1192, and in some works we find that he came in 1192. There are some minor controversies regarding the date of his coming to India, but that does not matter regarding the origin of the Sufism in India. Sufism in India actually have many silsilas which are known as Sufi orders or Sufi traditions. The major Sufi traditions in India were the Chishti, the Qadri, the Suhrawardi, the Naqshbandi, the Madari, the Firdausi, the Shattari, and a few minor traditions. Among these Sufi orders, the most important Sufi tradition, which was irrespective of caste, religion, creed, and the regional variations, was respected, followed by the people, was the Chishti order. The Chishti Sufi tradition was started, as I said, by Khwaja Moin-ud-din Chishti, who came to India in 1192 after the Battle of Thrain. The other Sufi, the major Sufis under this silsilas were Khwaja Qutubuddin Bakhtiyar Taqi, Fariduddin Ganje Shakar, Nizamuddin Aulia, Baba Farid, as well as Mia Mir. And apart from these five, there were several other Sufis who were attached to this Sufi order. Chishti Sufis has some practices of their own, which was not followed particularly by other Sufi orders. First, the Chishti Sufis never tried to have consort with the kings and officers. Second, they need not earn their livelihood. Futuh or willful or unasked charity which was given to them was the only source for their livelihood. The Chishti Sufis liked Sama or the devotional music. Their hospice or the Khanqah was open for all the common man, poor or rich, and they could sit and dine with the Sufis. The Sufis believed in the philosophy that Hamma az Ust. It means that everything is from Him. Him means the Almighty God. The Qadri tradition of Sufism was founded by Abdul Qadir Jilani, who lived in Baghdad, the capital of present Iraq. It was brought to India by a Sufi whose name was Abdul Karim Jilji in the year 1388. The real founder of this tradition of Sufism in India was in fact Sayyid Muhammad Ghaus Al-Qadri, who died in the year 1517. It was in fact the fag end of the Sultanate period, and after that Mughal period started. He came from Baghdad to India and he settled in Uch in the year 1482. From Uch in Multan, this Sufi order reached to other places in India, including Bihar and Bengal. These two places in eastern India are very famous for these two, for this Sufi order, particularly the Qadri Silsila or the Qadri tradition. This Suhrawardi tradition was founded by Sheikh Shahabuddin Suhrawardi at Suhraward. Suhrawardi is a place in Persia. It was brought to India by a Sufi whose name was Bahauddin Zakaria, Haminuddin Nagauri, Jalaluddin Tabrizi, and some others were the other prominent Sufis of this tradition. They maintained independent view regarding secular and religious problems in the society. They maintained very good relations with the kings and officials. They believed that this world and the attributes of this world, whatever had been created by God on this earth, they are for the use of the human being. Hence, why to lead a simple life? The things which God have given to us, they should enjoy these things, the fruits, the comfort of life. They should also be used by the Sufis like other persons use them. The Shattari order is also popular among the common people. The term Shattari has come out from the Arabic word Shatr. Shatr means to move very quickly. This Sufi order was founded by Shah Abdullah Shattari. The Shattari order believed in the practices which were very common to the Hindu practices in India. The Hindu yogis, their practices were very similar to the Shattari practices. The Madari Sufi order was popular among such people who did not have any type of following of the orthodox rituals in Islam. They were very much resembling to the Hindu yogis. They used to rub ashes on their body. They used to perform yoga, as well as they used to wear black turban and have a black flag in their hand. They did not observe fast and they seldom offer prayer or namaz. Badiuddin Madar in Kalpi was the exponent of this Madari Sufi order in India. The Naqshbandi Sufi order was founded by Khwaja Moin-ud-din Bukhari. He was the Sufi who was the main exponent of this Sufi tradition, which became very popular in India, particularly during the Mughal period. Khwaja Muhammad Baqi Billah was the person who brought this Sufi order to India. Khwaja Baqi Billah died in the year 1603. In 1605, Akbar died. It means that the period of Baqi Billah was the period of Akbar. The other leading Sufis of this order were Sheikh Abdul Haq Dehlavi as well as Khwaja Sheikh Ahmad Sarhindi. These two were also very famous. So far as this Naqshbandi Sufi order is concerned, it was very different from the other Sufi silsilas in India. They were different in the sense that they stressed on the orthodox interpretation and its application so far as the canons or the Sharia of Islam was concerned. And they propounded a new philosophy, a new concept that came to be known as Wahdatul Shahud. Wahdatul Shahud means the experience of the divine God in the heart on the basis of ecstasy. With the foundation of the Mughal rule, the Sufis and their tradition entered into a new phase. We find that during the Sultanate period, most of the kings were to great extent orthodox. Not a single ruler during the Sultanate period was as liberal as Akbar. But the Sufis during the Sultanate period were very liberal. They were having sympathy for the common man. They tried to harmonize the society. And the harmonious trend was established by them. Hence we see that on the one hand the rulers were orthodox and the Sufis were liberal. When the Mughal period came, this setup was changed. Now, particularly from the time of Akbar, because Babur did not have much time to settle or look into the things relating to the society or the other matters. He ruled only for 4 years, and during that period he tried to establish his newly founded kingdom. Humayun did not have much time for this. Akbar was the ruler who looked into that the Mughal rule could be permanently established in India and it should have been founded on such forces which could give stability to the Mughal dynasty and the Mughal rule. For such cause, Akbar adopted a very liberal policy. He had matrimonial alliance with the Rajputs. Akbar did not implement jizya. He abolished jizya. Pilgrim taxes were abolished. And a very liberal attitude was adopted by Akbar regarding all the caste, creed, and the religious traditions in India. He started Ibadat Khana in Fatehpur Sikri. And in this way, Akbar was on the whole the believer in the philosophy of Wahdatul Wajud. He believed in the unity of being. But the Sufi order during the time of Akbar, the Naqshbandi school or the Naqshbandi tradition was different. This Naqshbandi tradition believed that the attitude, the steps which were adopted by Akbar regarding harmonizing the society was against the canonical law or the Sharia of Islam. The Naqshbandi Sufis adopted a very orthodox outlook regarding the Muslim society as well as the Sharia. In such condition, Sheikh Ahmad Sarhindi had a tussle with Akbar. He did not have good relations with Akbar the Great. He did not like the policies of Akbar. In such condition, there was problem regarding adjustment with the ulamas and Sufis with the rulers. During this tussle, the nobles as well as the army officers, they also had the problem, because Sheikh Ahmad Sarhindi tried to influence the nobles, those who were attached to power, those who were in the army, and in such condition, the problem began very too serious, and in such condition, there was a clear-cut demarcation between the Sufis as well as the rulers. When Akbar declared Mahzar, he called himself Imam-e-Adil, and he also assumed the right of the interpretation of the Islamic law. In this way, he had the power of Mujtahid. This became very problematic for those who were having belief in the orthodox school of Sharia like Sheikh Ahmad Sarhindi. After that, the 1 million or 1,000 year was completed by the Islamic calendar from the date of the Hijri of Prophet Muhammad. In such condition, Akbar issued a new type of coin that was known as Alaf coin. This coin was for the purpose of memorizing the completion of 1 millennium by Islam. In such condition, Sheikh Ahmad Sarhindi, he also began to call himself Mujaddide Alafe Sani. It means that the regenerator or revival of the second millennium, means beginning of the second millennium. Mujaddide Alafe Sani was the title which was used by Sheikh Ahmad Sarhindi, and his followers used to call him Mujaddid. In this way, Sheikh Ahmad Sarhindi tried to revive the orthodox aspect, the conservative aspects of Islam and his Sharia. In such condition, this tussle between Sheikh Ahmad Sarhindi and the Mughal rulers, particularly Akbar, continued. After that, in 1605, Akbar died. When Akbar passed away, Sheikh Ahmad Sarhindi very much felt relief. He thought that the person who disturbed or introduced so many things which were against the spirit of Islam had passed away. After Akbar, Jahangir came to power, and Sheikh Ahmad Sarhindi began to influence Jahangir so that he could not follow the liberal policies of Akbar. In such condition, the problem was regarding the Shias, who were very liberal and they were attached to the sovereign power. Nur Jahan, who was a Persian and she was the wife of Jahangir, she was a Shia. Her brother Asaf Khan and others were very close of Jahangir. In such condition, Sheikh Ahmad Sarhindi thought that under the influence of Asaf Khan and other Shias, Jahangir would follow the liberal policies of Akbar. In such condition, Sheikh Ahmad Sarhindi wrote a book. The name of the book was Radde Rawafiz. It was against the Shi'i practices. When Asaf Khan came to know of this book, he asked Jahangir to invite Sheikh Ahmad Sarhindi to the court, Mughal royal court. And he thought that Sheikh Ahmad Sarhindi had no respect for Jahangir. He asked Jahangir that when Sheikh Ahmad Sarhindi would enter the royal court in the presence of the public, he would be asked to perform the sajda, that is known as prostration, before the king. When Sheikh Ahmad Sarhindi entered the court, he was asked for performing prostration, that is in the honor of the royal king, but Sheikh Ahmad Sarhindi refused because he thought that such type of prostration was only for God and not for the kings or rulers. In such condition, Asaf Khan told that Sheikh Ahmad Sarhindi did not respect Jahangir and he did not respect the royal canons or the privileges of the king. In such condition, Sheikh Ahmad Sarhindi was arrested. He was sent to the Gwalior jail and he was put under the jail for 1 year. After 1 year, Sheikh Ahmad Sarhindi was released and Sheikh Ahmad Sarhindi again began to influence Jahangir. Later on, Jahangir gave respect to Sheikh Ahmad Sarhindi. He gave 1,000 tanka to him and a robe of honor. Later on, he influenced Jahangir. The tension between the state and Sufism became less, particularly after the release of Sheikh Ahmad Sarhindi. Before we close this lecture, we should have some idea regarding one or two other aspects regarding two, three Sufis who played very important role regarding the harmonizing the Indian society as well as the two major religions, Islam and Hinduism, as well as Islam and Sikhism. It is well known that Baba Farid was the very leading Sufi of the Qadri school. His disciple was Mian Mir. Mian Mir was born in 1550 and he died in the year 1636. During the period of Akbar and Jahangir, he flourished. Mian Mir was such a liberal Sufi. He resided in Multan and Guru Arjun Dev, who was the fifth Sikh Guru, he was also very much influenced by the philosophy of Baba Farid and Mian Mir. When the foundation of Golden Temple was to be laid down, Guru Arjun Dev invited Mian Mir. He was very old and he was brought to Amritsar from Multan. And it is very interesting that foundation of the Golden Temple in Amritsar was laid down by the Islamic Sufi Mian Mir. And this Mian Mir, his Wani, his sayings are very popular. His Wani as well as the Wani or the sayings of Baba Farid are part of Guru Granth Sahib. The other Sufi who was very significant were two. One was Dara Shikoh, the eldest son of Shah Jahan, and the other was Mirza Mazhar Jane Jana. Dara Shikoh was a very learned person. He was a great Sufi. He had learnt Sanskrit and he had studied Vedas and Upanishad also. He translated Upanishads into Persian and he gave it the title Sirr-e-Akbar, the great secret. Then he, with the Sanskrit scholars of Benares, he translated Vedas and he named it Majmaul Bahrain. In the book Majmaul Bahrain, he had made a comparative study of Quran as well as Vedas. Majmaul Bahrain means meeting of the two oceans. It was through the Majmaul Bahrain that the European scholars came to know of the Indian Vedas. A third book was also written by Dara Shikoh. Its name was Sakinatul Awliya. In this work, he has written the biographies of 107 Sufis. This work is also important so far as the study of the Sufism is concerned. This philosophy, this theory of Dara Shikoh was not liked by Aurangzeb as well as the orthodox ulamas who issued the fatwa or the doctrine that Dara Shikoh should be killed, and ultimately Dara Shikoh had been killed. But the ethos, the concept, the philosophy which was given by Dara Shikoh on the deep study of Vedas as well as the Quran, their comparative study continued in India, and Mirza Mazhar Jane Jana, who lived during the time of Aurangzeb, continued the philosophy of Dara Shikoh, and he also stressed that Hindus were not kafirs, they were Ahle Kitab, they were men of book, and the Vedas were the books of God, they were given by gods, and in this way, the Sufi tradition continued in India.